Hi everyone, my name is Sara Nedrich and I'm an aquatic toxicologist with Michigan's Department of Environment, Great Lakes and Energy. And this is a great follow-up to Ruth's talk. Thank you, Ruth, for all that background. You really set me up just right here because we're gonna talk about some sampling efforts we did last summer to investigate 6PPD-quinone in surface water and standing road water in Michigan. I can kind of skip through a lot of this background, which is great. So I guess the main things to know are, let's see. Okay. One, 6PPD-quinone is released from tire wear particles. So it's associated with traffic and it's an oxidation product of 6PPD. And then also it's pretty darn toxic to cold water fish we're finding. So the Tian et al. Article published found really low LC50, so that's the lethal concentration at which 50% of the organisms have mortality. So that's a really low number. And then just recently in February, a really great article came out from Brinkman et al. 2022, where they found also very low LC50s for brook trout and rainbow trout. So this is really concerning for Michigan because brook trout are native species that are really important for our fisheries. Resident species is rainbow trout, not native, but also very important. So it's really interesting right now. They just came out with a standard, commercial standard for 6PPD-quinone. So a lot of these tox studies are based on sort of lab-made standards. So I'm unsure if we'll be able to use all of these studies in deriving kind of like an acute or a water quality standard for the state. But if we were able to with these numbers, the value would be about 8 nanograms per liter for acute effects, which is really low. So this is why we're investing time and research money into investigating how prevalent it is in Michigan's waters. We also are really interested in potential sources that go beyond tire wear particles. So in Michigan, we actually fund grants to come up with new innovative ways to use scrap tires. A lot of states have problems with scrap, having too many tires and not having stuff to do with them. They can be really dangerous to landfill. So implementing them in these recycled uses is promoted. This study also looked at places where crumb rubber was applied in asphalt paving. In Michigan, scrap tires are classified as inert and therefore they can be put to beneficial reuse. And this is not just common to Michigan, actually in the United States, about 4% of all reused tires go toward modified asphalt. All right, so now I'll head into our sampling plan and results. So the start of any good sampling plan is defining your research questions. So these might seem a little boring from an academic's perspective, but as a regulator, this is really the types of questions that we're looking at. One, we wanna know, is 6PPD-quinone present in Michigan surface water at concentrations that's impacting aquatic life? Two, we were interested in industrial sources. Could there be an industrial source where we have these crumb rubber stockpiles used in our road paving projects? Three, we wanted to actually look at some of our historic crumb rubber paving grants that we handed out, test runoff from those roadways. And then we also wanted to look at specifically tying exposure. So looking at where we actually have trout spawning, are we getting concentrations of 6PPD-quinone? So those were really, really hefty questions, but we did our best. We collected about 17 surface water samples from 12 different watersheds. You see on the map on the right here. We sampled surface water from tributaries or creeks that ran like perpendicular to the roadway, so intersected with the roadway, or parallel, ran along a roadway and collected runoff. We had five different site categories, three of which related to the crumb rubber question, looking at historic sites, pre-2018 paved, recent was 2019 or 2020 paved with like a traditional asphalt reference upstream. And then we had we had three sites that were being paved in the summer of 2021. So we were able to go out and collect surface water samples prior to that paving and then after to compare. Our two exposure sites was in the St. Joseph River and then in the Clinton River on the east side of the state. And our areas where the crumb river stockpiles or industrial sites were is in Grand Rapids. And there was actually a site just on the border of Ohio. The site is technically in Ohio, but we were able to grab a sample from the southern part of Michigan. And then we also collected five standing road water samples, so basically a sample from a puddle along five of our sites. And then also conducted 5-minute car counts just while we were on the site to compare traffic between our sites. One controversial aspect that was really hard to make a decision on was when to take a sample relative to the start of a sort of runoff event. So at this time, we had about 3 months to like draft the sampling plan and pull it all together. So we didn't have time to get our auto samplers up and working. So we really had to pick a time to take a discrete sample. So we based our sampling regime off of Cassandra Johannesson's master's thesis work, where she actually took auto sampler readings and kind of coined the term in her paper that 6PPD-quinone has this middle flush dynamic. So once the storm event starts, she saw it starting to peak around 11 hours and then decreasing about 35 hours. And then she also timed it in terms of peak discharge. So from that, we defined our storm event as greater than a half inch of rain, and then timed it to be 11 to 35 hours after the start of a rain event, or 6 to 30 hours after peak discharge. All right, so into our results. I was actually quite happy to see that we got a lot of non-detects, which means that we're not having to deal with this problem everywhere all over the state. So another reason for the high number of non-detects is that a lot of the crumb river paving sites we looked at were in rural areas. So as Ruth mentioned, the presence of 6PPD-quinone is really strongly tied to urban high traffic environments. So the two places we did get detections, we got a detection of 37 nanograms per liter. That was along a drainage ditch, actually collecting runoff from a really busy highway. And then this 12 nanograms per liter was in Grand Rapids along Plaster Creek, which is downstream of our industrial source. It also has a large highway going through the middle of Grand Rapids that it could collect runoff from. And then another point, note to point out is that all of our crumb river sites were non-detect. That included the reference versus recent comparison as well in the, as the pre and post for the ones that were paved in 2021. So that was a good note as well. We wanted to check our sampling to make sure that we timed our sample collection correctly, and about 70% of the sites met at least one of our recommendations in terms of the timing of sampling. It was interesting. So a lot of sites, it was really hard to predict if a storm event was going to get to the 0.5 cutoff. Usually we had to start sampling before the rain event was over. So that was a little challenging. One of our detected sites actually ended up being on the low end in terms of the amount of rainfall. So I'm almost wondering if that's, and that's our industrial site, if that's more of a background reading. So it was very interesting trying to predict the flush dynamic of 6PPD-quinone because it's very time sensitive. All right, it was really interesting to see our puddle sample results. So we only collected 5 samples and all 5 samples came back with relatively high detections of 6PPD-quinone. So our lowest detection was 54 nanograms per liter, and this was on a roadway that was just recently paved with tire-derived asphalt. And then our highest concentration was at our industrial site along Plaster Creek, where we got the detection of 12 nanograms per liter in surface water. And yes, you can see the storm sewer right here. So yeah, there may be a connection between the source and what's getting into the river, but more follow-up research is needed on that specific site. With our car count data, we did see a moderate positive correlation between road traffic and 6PPD-quinone concentrations in standing road water. So again, this is only 5 data points, so it's a pretty weak relationship, but this data does pair in well with this concept that urban sites with high traffic are where you're gonna find it. All right, so to kind of bring it back around to our research questions, we did find that 6PPD-quinone is present in Michigan surface waters, but not as ubiquitous as we thought it would be, which is great news. And then for industrial sources, we did have the one Plaster Creek site where we got a detection, and we're gonna do follow-up studies of that specific site. All of our evidence, none of our evidence suggested that crumb rubber increases 6PPD-quinone release. But again, I would love to see another study kind of looking at this issue because it is really important. And then for the trout spawning rivers, both of them were non-detect. But again, we still think this is a really important issue and are gonna continue looking at it with auto samplers so we can be sure we got that peak 6PPD-quinone.
About 3 minutes left.
Thank you. Okay, so I'll just summarize really quickly. So we did find that 6PPD-quinone is being released from roadways from our puddle samples at pretty high concentrations. However, in a lot of places, it just doesn't seem to be getting into surface water from what we can tell so far. 6PPD-quinone is short-lived in aquatic systems. So getting time sequence data is really important to make sure you're getting that peak concentration and recommending auto samplers for new watersheds. And then acute effects of 6PPD-quinone continues to be a concern to aquatic life in Michigan, again, because it is so acutely toxic. We are really interested in continuing research on this front. Our next steps, we actually have 2 studies that we're planning for this summer. We're doing a watershed scale study follow-up in Grand Rapids at that industrial site with auto samplers. And there's also a tributary in that area that has spawning brook trout. So we're really interested in throwing an auto sampler in there too to see what we get. And then I'm also involved in a tire reuse study that's gonna compare runoff from a controlled test section of traditional asphalt and crumb rubber overlay. And this is in partnership with Michigan Tech University and also our waste division's scrap tire program. So it should be really interesting. Right, and just to kind of link you guys in, so our 6PPD data has been reported out. So you can go to this link here to download the report and read it. And then this is my contact info if you have any questions or feel free to contact Manhuva. And that concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Sara. We do have time for one question.
Okay, we have quite a few in, so I'll go with the first. For your reference toxicity data, have you all also looked at 6PPD plus high salt content? This could be a double whammy for the little fishies.
Ooh, no, I haven't. that sounds interesting. Chat me up.
We can do one more, Janice. That was a quick one.
Did you perform a storage stability test on 6PPDQ in surface water samples? Were there water samples preserved or frozen post-collection?
So I'm kind of blanking on the lab we worked with right now. They're back out, I'm sorry, it's Eurofins out in California. So they did that kind of testing. We did not use a preservative. They did test to show that it is stable as long as you refrigerate it upon collection. So that's what we went with.